Coming up this time on the show, we're going to be talking with the CTO of Zinuous, David Meyer, about their adoption of FreeBSD. We'll also discuss the BSD license model for businesses and the benefits of contributing changes back. BSD Now, episode 98, Our Code is Your Code, recorded July 15th, 2015. Hey, I'm your host, Chris Moore.
And I'm Alan Jude.
And we're glad to have you guys with us this week on BSD Now. We got an exciting episode and a great interview we got over at BSD Can. Mm-hmm. So we've been sitting on this one for a little bit, but we're ready to play it this week, and I hope you guys enjoy it. But before we get into that, of course, we got a lot of news to talk about. So what do we got first here this week, Alan? Something about ARM,
yes,
I believe.
Enabling FreeBSD on the ARM64 platform.
Ooh, fancy. Okay. Yeah, so of course, we've heard a lot about ARM64 recently, and the foundation's been involved. So what specifically are they doing on this?
So Cavium is one of the companies that makes ARM64 products, and they have one called the ThunderX platform, which is a 48-core ARM64 device. And they've been sponsoring the foundation to make FreeBSD work on it because, many vendors that are building embedded applications and so on would really rather have something BSD licensed than something not. It's FreeBSD is a popular platform there. And, you know, FreeBSD itself has quite a goal to be the go-to operating system in that space because we have that licensing advantage over other operating systems.
Sure.
You know, the FreeBSD Foundation's been working on this, sponsoring people to work on it, and quite a bit of it's getting done. But now there's actually an article about it on the ARM.com main website. So that's some, big kind of coverage for what's normally kind of a under-the-hood type working stuff.
Sure.
But
stuff that happens behind the scenes.
Yeah, and it kind of talks about a bit of FreeBSD history and how we actually ended up working on ARM64.
Okay. So it looks like not only that, even a few months ago, they got things like D-Trace working on the new architecture. So it's definitely making progress here.
Yeah. So the plan is that FreeBSD 11, when it comes out next year, will have ARM64 as a tier one platform, meaning it'll be as high quality as the AMD 64 port that everybody uses now. And that means full binary updates and packages and everything that you could expect from using FreeBSD on a regular x86 server.
Well, yeah, I'm looking at their ThunderX here. So getting a system with 48 cores, 2.5 gigahertz core frequency. Shoot, get one of those so we could build the ARM packages natively. I might be able to build those faster than I'm doing my AMD 64 packages with that many extra cores.
Right. And
that's incredible.
If you check out this stuff from BSD Can, they did a presentation there about, the last year of working on ARM64. And they also have some cool pictures of the hardware, because everybody loves hardware.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah, there's a couple pictures attached here, and I'm looking at their product page as well. Yeah, this is nice. Well, that's cool. I'm really looking forward to 11 then. There's a lot of neat stuff coming.
Yes.
Okay, well, next up in the news here, we got some TCP dump information for you. So OpenBSD, of course, has TCP dump, and you're probably somewhat familiar with it. If you're a network admin or just been around Unix long enough, you've probably had to pull out TCP dump for something in the past. And, of course, it's a very useful packet sniffing, and it's a capturing utility that's pretty much included in all BSDs. But what we have here is a link to a cool YouTube video here talking about the version that's in OpenBSD specifically, which has gone through some major changes. So they've really ripped it up and changed it around a bit here. So it's pretty much a fork now with no version number. So that's interesting.
It's just OpenBSD TCP dump.
OpenBSD's TCP dump. There you go. So what are the differences here? So unlike some of the other platforms, OpenBSD's TCP dump's always going to run in a cheroot as an unprivileged user. So that's good and could possibly save you from high-profile exploits. Also, it looks like they've added support for the PS.OS system, or PF.OS system, sorry, allowing you to filter out operating system fingerprints in the packet captures.
Yeah, so it's using that database that comes with PF for figuring out what operating system remote system is and allows you to, show me a TCP dump of only Windows traffic.
That's right. Yeah, that's really slick. But man, somebody needs to port that over to FreeBSD TCP dump. But anyway, they also have a PF and PF log integration, allowing you to see which line in your rule set triggered a specific match. I can see how that'd be handy. Yeah. And of course, being able to run this directly on your router, if you followed our OpenBSD router tutorial, is pretty awesome. Like Alan said, being able to say, okay, only show me the Windows clients on the network. How cool is that?
Yeah. The PF log, there is some integration with the TCP dump in FreeBSD. And in FreeBSD, our TCP dump has Capsicum for privilege separation, and it sandboxes itself after it opens the NIC. So it's designed to provide the same kind of protection as you would get with the CHROOT, but it's done in a quite a bit different way. But yes.
Okay.
But yeah that sounds like there's a bunch of improvements in their TCP dump that might be applicable to FreeBSD as well.
Where's the portable? We need a portable version. Yes. Right? Come on, guys. I need some more OpenBSD goodness in my PCBSD here. Yes. That would be awesome. But yeah, you guys take a look after the show here. Take a look at the YouTube video if you'd like to find out more details on that, what some of the differences are, and how you can use that on your OpenBSD box. Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, next up, FreeBSD Foundation. I know it's been a while since BSD Can now, but we're still doing wrap-up from that. There was so much that happened there.
Yes.
So, next up, we have the Foundation has sent another round of trip reports out from this year's BSD Can. So you want to read off who we're starting with here,
Alan? Yeah, if the FreeBSD Foundation sponsors you to go to a conference of any type, one of the things you have to do is write a trip report explaining what you did while you were there and how it benefited the community. And basically, you know, it's what they charge you in exchange for sponsoring you to go to the conference. And they're always really interesting to read, so I'm glad they do that. So the first one here is from Camille, and he talks about going to BSD Can and getting to meet a bunch of people, including, he said, Gavin Atkinson provided him an invite to the Developer Summit and mentoring his new project, and also Werner Lusch for getting him into some meetings and so on. He said he arrived in Ottawa on the Tuesday, found the residence, got all checked in and all that, and then he tried out the Developer Summit and tutorials, but he started with a tutorial, Michael W. Lucas's FreeBSD storage for sysadmins, and you know, he said even though I was experiencing jet lag, he did like to get to enjoy that. He also says he came to the working group on designing universal config files that I ran, and he said it was very interesting discussion about dividing system utilities for targets that should be UCL'd and which one shouldn't be. And you know, he liked the idea of the show running config of a single compiled config of the entire system configuration. I very much like that idea as well. That was actually suggested by Paul Schenkeveld at Age of BSD Con before he passed away. And he said at the end of the first Dev Summit tutorial day, he moved to the Hacker Lounge in the residence, and then he had dinner with a bunch of interesting people from Poland that he met at BSD Can. And then the second day, I said on the second day, he did the tutorial about DNSSEC. And because of that, he missed the documentation in ARMv8 working groups. But he did get, after the group photo, he did get to go to the OpenZFS working group. And he found that very interesting. And then he talks about on what he did on once the actual conference started and talking about stuff. But he also talks about after lunch, he found Chris Moore and told him about a patch he had for FreeBSD update. And then that directed him to Colin, who finally, with Alan Shute, myself, and Nathan Whitehorn, was supported by Zin Lee. And we actually got a bug closed and the problem solved. So,
sweet. Which one was that again, Alan?
I think that was being able to run FreeBSD update from without a console from like Puppet and other orchestration type systems. Yep. So that was, you know, it's always good to see, you know, when we actually get a problem that's been outstanding solved because you were able to do it in person. His was a patch that he came up with that makes FreeBSD update detect if you don't have /user/source filled out. So and automatically disable it so that people stop getting that error every time there's an OpenSSL update that adds a new source file. And then FreeBSD update tries to install it, even though you don't have the rest of the source code, and so the parent directory doesn't exist. And
So we just turned off source updating entirely.
Right. Well, that makes sense.
The update because
that makes sense for PC BSD. Yeah, but so now the one for FreeBSD update will skip source if it detects that you don't have any of the expected file. Like if you don't have the copyright file in user source, then it assumes you don't have any source code, and that and goes on. So it was good to see getting specific problems fixed as well, though. And it kind of, you know, that'd been going back and forth on email for a while. But when you get all those people in the same room, it's just like boop, 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 and it's done.
You solve the problem exactly. Much faster. Like the latency is much reduced.
Yep. Next one was from Christian Brufer.
Yep. Well, I got to read one of the quotes here he says about the Dev Summit, which is awesome. He said, the next day marked the start of the Dev Summit. He said, it's hard to find a better place to get things done than in this inspiring atmosphere. Single-mindedly focused on FreeBSD and uninterrupted FreeBSD time is something I usually lack, so I managed to make progress on a few long-standing to-do items. Mm-hmm. But he talks about the OpenVSM repository from FreeBSD Perforce server to Git, which is cool. So he got some time to work on that. And then he said after doing some work there and then afterwards, he's finally been able to move all that to GitHub. So another thing he says he explored was using Beehive as a provider for Vagrant, which could be interesting. I can see some cool stuff coming out of that. He then talks about on the second day of the Dev Summit, he got to participate in the documentation working group, which I was in there. And he finally got to meet some of the most active people there in the last few years. He said he had a good day with Warren Block as the ringleader there, talking about everything from translation to doc toolchain to man pages. And as a special treat was the presence of having Ingo Suarez there from the OpenBSD project and the maintainer of Mandoc package, as well as Ryan Lorty from GNOME. He said having outside experiences definitely benefited the discussion. Yes, for sure.
Yes.
He said one of his goals was discussing moving the release documentation from the source repository into its own docs repository, which allows them to make corrections after a release, which is a great idea. He said it was a good discussion, and Hiroki Saito explained some issues that he hadn't considered beforehand. But then he wraps up here. He said the conference itself was fantastic. It doesn't happen every day that you have people like Stephen Borm, Andrew Tenenbaum, and Kirk Mikuza all under the same roof. Yeah, that's for sure, right? But it is pretty special when that happens. He said there was a lot of great talks, but he said the most interesting one for him was molecular evolution, genomic analysis, and FreeBSD. So that's definitely one. You should go watch that video if you haven't seen it yet. He said he's actually a graduate student in cancer genomics, so he said that's you know, closely related to his field, using a lot of the same issues and tools. Mm-hmm. So yeah, he said biological and medical research is currently dominated by Linux, with the problem that most scientific researchers usually don't write the best and most portable code. Yep. So that does make it a little more difficult to use BSD, but he says oftentimes you want to try out software from the latest research paper, of course. But it turns out Joseph, who gave that talk, had some experience as well, but found that Beehive had enough of a low overhead to make this feasible, where you could run the Linux Beehive VM and do this all on FreeBSD. So he said, my hope is we can work together and make FreeBSD a better platform that for this kind of research. And then he mentions here he did spend some time in the hacker and doc lounges where the discussions and work continued. And he said he learned a lot, and it was astounding to see all the cool stuff other people have been working on, which motivates him to work and make FreeBSD better himself.
And separately, special thanks to Christian for helping me out over the last week, getting a bunch of changes to the installer done in time for 10.2.
Nice. Okay, well, you have to tell us which changes those are. Just throw that out.
Mostly just tiny cleanup things, making var audit a separate data set so it doesn't get boot environmented on you. Fixing a typo. And lastly, adding workaround support for the Lenovos that refuse to boot in BIOS mode if you use a GPT partition. I've finally come up with
quite a
fix
thread
for that.
About this week.
Yes. Well, I actually have a working fix for that that's now been integrated and committed as part of GPart. So if you just do GPart set minus a Lenovo fix on a disk, it fixes it. For that, it does a horrible hack that makes that Lenovo work.
Okay.
And so I'm working on adding that as an option to the installer.
To the installer.
Possibly with auto detection. So it'll be like, you have one of the affected Lenovos, so I'm going to set that as the default for you, but not for everybody else.
Or even prompt. We detect or suspect you're on a Lenovo. Do you want to apply this fix?
You have a Lenovo that's cool. Known not to work well. Would you like us to try to apply this fix that should make it work better?
So what was it specifically for? It wouldn't boot off GPT?
Yeah, basically when it...
BIOS mode or something?
So yeah, when you use BIOS mode and you try to boot off GPT partition, when it sees the, it looks and there's, in a master boot record, there are four slots. When you have GPT partition, it makes a fake master boot record with one partition that covers the whole disk that just has a special type, EE, that says, hey, this is GPT partitioned, ignore this, or you know, read it as GPT instead. But for whatever reason, when you're not in EFI mode, the Lenovo's freak out and won't boot off of it. However, if you write in the PMBR, you put that EE partition in the second slot, which is a valid thing to do, if the first slot's all zeros, then the Lenovo boots fine. Basically, you trick it into not thinking it's GPT or something, and then it just boots. I'm not entirely sure what is the cause, but somebody had found the way to fix it, but their steps for doing it were all manual and kind of nasty, whereas I basically reverse engineered what the actual fix was out of that by hex editing the master boot record before and after and so on, and then codified that into a little bit of code in the gpart command.
Nice. Well, I don't think I ran into that here on mine, probably because I was using UEFI for my booting. So
for mine, I wasn't because I needed ZFS and FreeBSD doesn't boot. So, and, you know, I didn't have Grub going. Anyway.
That's right. Yes. Right. Well, I'll let you do the third report here and I'll take the fourth.
Yes. So, so the third one is from Warren Block, who's one of my mentors as a FreeBSD documentation committer. And he says, you know, BSD CAN is the largest conference for BSDs in North America, and it was in Ottawa. And he says, thanks to the people at FOSS-LC, there are recordings of high audio quality of all of the talks, and they're all, most all of those are on YouTube now, which is great. He talks about the Developer Summit. You know, he says, lucky enough to give the Documentation Working Group's presentation. And he did a good presentation talking about some of the problems we have, especially with translations. And, you know, he was glad to see that. And it says, you know, it turns out that not only are some of the things not impossible to fix, but there was a lot of enthusiasm and interest in actually getting them fixed, which is, you know, always nice to hear. So he'd say, he talked about revamping the translation system and trying to catch up with PCBSD and using Poodle. And, you know, one of the major points was encouraging people to contribute to the documentation and lowering the barriers to make such contributions easier. You know, live demonstrations of some of this stuff and, you know, hold my beer and watch this. specifically talking about annotator.js, which is a way that you can, for reviewing existing documentation, specifically if you're just a regular user and you don't know the markup language that we use to write the docs, where you could take the HTML web page version of our current, you know, handbook and mark up a bunch of changes that you think should be made and give us something that you could submit, and then we can handle the markup for it and so on. Because, you know, oftentimes it's for the documenter, it's not necessarily the markup that's hard, it's knowing what to write and so on. He also talked about the FreeBSD wiki and it's being underused, and it's kind of, you know, many people say it's where documentation goes to die. you know, but saying, but it does allow more people to contribute without lowering our standards of quality. You know, get the information in there, and then it can get migrated into the handbook once it's been polished up. He actually forgot to mention his idea where new wiki contributors would automatically generate reviews at reviews.freebsd.org or Fabricator instance, either with a special group of wiki reviewers or something like that, so that then any committer could then just click approve and it would end up being live in the wiki after that, which is definitely an interesting workflow.
Yeah, that's interesting.
Then we talked about the FreeBSD.org website. And everyone agrees it should be updated, but no one agrees exactly how. but
how, when, what, you know, where and what technology and all that.
Yes. So the FreeBSD Foundation has recently updated their site, and there's some interest in making our website look similar. And so there's going to be some discussion about that. He also mentions the doc lounges, which are, you know, a much less formal way for new people to get started. So these run basically most of the time overlapping with the Hacker Lounge. but basically in a room somewhere that's quieter than the Hacker Lounge, which can be a bit loud sometimes, a bunch of doc committers and people interested in working on docs show up, and you know, basically you can get paired off with a doc committer, and they'll walk you through actually getting your first patch committed, or you know, going through Bugzilla, finding an outstanding you know, problem report that somebody's reported with documentation, fixing it, and actually getting it committed. And we find that, you know, the best way to make doc committers is actually get them to commit a couple things at the conference, and then they'll go home and they'll send more stuff to be committed after that.
Yep.
And then he talks about, you know, a bunch of the presentations, and also as part of the kind of lightning talk track, Warren gave a talk about thinking about installers, Discord, and happiness, about the different views of installers and how they make the job of installing FreeBSD much easier, regardless of the amount of customization needed for your target system. And so I definitely want to check out that one, because I'd like to make our installer that much easier to use.
Sure.
You know, people keep making requests to add extra functionality to it. It's like, I do, but I don't want to make it more complicated. What's the right way to do this?
Yeah, it is kind of a trade-off. You almost need to make the back end as complicated as possible, so everything's supported, but then the front end you expose to your typical user just installing from DVD is a lot more simplified.
Kind of what I was thinking instead was having a directory full of profile scripts that just have like a name and a description, and then the user just picks one of those, and then it just blats out the system. You know, maybe they have a couple parameters, like what disks to use. But like that's
This is close enough to what I need, and then you can adjust the few small things.
Yeah, so it's like, take this set of disks and make this or that or the other thing. And, you know, cool. You know, basically with the ZFS stuff, we're offering mirroring and RAID 7, but you know, being able to do a UFS on a gmir is not something the installer does currently. And you know, I'd like to do that, but it's all of a sudden now there are 80 possibilities when you do an install, and it's like that's, you know, kind of a lot.
Sure.
You know.
Okay.
Yes.
Oh, you want me to get the last on to the next one here? Okay. Before we run out of time. Last one. We promise you. The last report here is from Shanali Balakrishna. I'm sorry if I mispronounced that. But he talks about coming out to the conference. He said he came in on June 12th, which was the first day of the scheduled talks, which he said he showed up very sleep deprived after the finals week at grad school. So, wow, the fact you made it, awesome. Glad you were there. Yes. He said it was incredible listening to the Stephen Bourne talk about the creation of Bourne Shell, which I think everyone would agree with you hands down that was an incredible talk. He said in particular some of the other talks he really enjoyed was FreeBSD operations at Limelight Networks, the content delivery CDN. He said a lot of that stuff interests him, having done a research component out at grad school. So he talks about how big CDNs with many data centers and large-scale installations of FreeBSD on the edge is such an important factor. He talks about, in the talk, he learned about while deploying FreeBSD, their strategies involve upstreaming everything using ports, creating a source team, and that tools by Limelight were also discussed. He said also an interesting talk was a cloud ABI by Ed Schouten, which we've interviewed before, which is a Unix application binary interface which provides a capability-based security. So it extends the concepts of Capsicum, he said, by providing a more compact representation with only about 60 system calls. So he talks a little bit about that. And, of course, another talk he hit was Introduction to the Implementation of ZFS by Kirk McCusick, which is, of course, incredible because Kirk was giving the talk. But he said mentions here in his write-up about the fire alarm going off in the middle of the talk, followed by the arrival of all the fire trucks and how much fun that was. But he said he loved the talk for the clarity at which Dr. McCusick explained the ZFS block structure and checkpointing, and he made simple the rather complex concepts like freeing on the file system and snapshot blocks in ZFS. Mm-hmm. And, of course, he mentions that the closing sessions were quite a lot of fun. And in addition, he enjoyed meeting people such as Gavin Atkinson, who was the administrator for all the GSOC students at FreeBSD last year.
And so, this year, in like the last 10 years.
Yeah. Yeah, Gavin's been doing a lot of that. But he mentions he really enjoyed going to see Otto, an incredible city to visit. Really enjoyed the history and culture, and he got soaked in all the museums and art galleries and beautiful hiking trails. So he got some extra time to do some more stuff out there. But in terms of work he says he wants to do for FreeBSD in the future, besides wrapping up the testing of BSNMP IPv6, he said he learned about some other projects he could contribute to in the future, like further IPv6 support, such as user line cleanup, unification of ping and ping 6, unification of traceroute and traceroute 6, and improvements to Bluetooth, 802.11, and others. So it sounds like he got his FreeBSD battery all charged up. That's awesome.
Look forward to seeing many commits.
Yes, definitely. Yeah, yeah. Send those commits in now. Okay, well, we went through a lot of that here, but we got one more thing to go to as we wrap up the news. So Dragonfly BSD on the Chromebook C720. So if you've got one of those laying around and you aren't particularly happy with that OS that it came pre-installed with, well, it turns out Dragonfly BSD may be worth a go on it. So we have a link to an article here, basically a little mini report on how Dragonfly functions on the device as a desktop. And they do mention, of course, 2 gigs of RAM is a bit limiting, but most of the hardware is pretty well supported. And we even have linked to a full wiki page on Dragonfly's site talking about this device and getting it set up as well. So if you have one and like to throw a BSD on it, that may be a attractive option.
Yes, he also mentions that the binary packages were very helpful, making installation and updates almost effortless, especially going binary only. And yeah, talks about some problems he had with the mouse pad as well.
Nice. Well, and, you know, the usual, I'm looking at their wiki page here, the usual suspects, setting some sysctls and how to do Wi-Fi setup on here, which modules specifically you need to load so you have the touchpad and the touchscreen working, which is pretty cool that they have that. Okay, well, that is neat. But before we go get into our interview, which we promised, we do got a sponsor to talk about first this week, which is going to be iX Systems that we're starting with.
Yep.
And the URL for that, ixsystems.com/BSDnow. And I think we have a new article to talk about that they've posted this week on why we use ZFS, Alan.
So in addition to their regular, the ultimate guide for buying a new server, which, you know, I actually finished my order with them this morning. So
what'd you get?
Well, one server with 36 terabyte helium drives.
Oh, you know,
That's going in a data center. And then for my house, two servers with 24 SATA drives each.
Nice.
And, you know, the latest dual processor Haswells with, you know, all the greatness, DDR4 and everything. Mm-hmm. Should be lots of fun.
Very cool. Very cool. So I assume you have this article you can pull up here on why we use ZFS that they just posted.
Yeah. But, so this is explaining why iX uses ZFS as underlying technology for TrueNAS and FreeNAS, and a little bit more about what ZFS is. And it's a good article that quickly goes over some of the high points of ZFS, you know, copy on write, the better RAID protections, the scalability, intelligent features like the combining volume management and file system and the RAID controller and so on, but also transparent compression and the smarter file system cache, you know, keeping track of your most recently used files, but also your most frequently used files, and keeping track of those two things separately actually turns out to make a big difference in your cache hit ratio. And we all know that you know, the more things you can pull out of RAM instead of off the disk, the better you're going to get performance, right? But also, snapshots and replication make a huge difference. And then, you know, the fact that it's open source means that, you know, they'll be able to keep following it. They'll be able to contribute back. And, you know, it just makes for a better business decision to base on open source, because, you know, it's not going to just go away on you or something like that.
Mm-hmm. That's right. So, of course, folks, if you go talk to these guys at iX, these guys are experts on everything. ZFS, you know, BSD, open source in general, and they know how to integrate the hardware to make all that happen and make that a system hum. So, Alan, you'll have to show us some pictures once your systems arrive, since you got two coming to the house, for sure. Maybe a little unboxing video would be cool.
Yes. Sadly, the unboxing for those is pretty lame, because it's literally just you pull the machine out of the box and it's done.
Well, you unbox it, maybe crack the lid open.
Yes, I'll have to open it up and let you see inside.
Let us see under the hood a little bit.
We'll have to, send a note to iX that they should make some videos of them building the server.
That would be awesome. Yes. That would be awesome. So again, folks, that URL is going to be ixsystems.com/BSDnow. When you talk to them, please mention us. Yes. Tell them that you heard it here on BSD Now. Okay, so we're joined now by David Meyer here at BSDCAN, who's the CTO of Zenuous. So first of all, am I saying that right? It's pronounced Zenuous?
Zenuous.
Zenuous, okay.
Or you can think of it as Zen.
Okay, there you go. There you go. So first of all, thank you for coming on the show with us this week. We really appreciate it.
Thank you. Glad to be here.
Yeah, and thank you guys for all coming out to BSD Camp. I saw that you guys are sponsoring.
Yes, we are. Year. We're nice. Good citizens of open source.
That is fantastic. Yes. Yeah. That is fantastic. So we'll get into what Genuus does here in a moment, but sure. Tell us about yourself a little bit. What was your first experience with BSD, and what brought you here?
It's going to date me.
Hey,
so we'll start with that. I won't tell you the years, but it's gone back to PCBSD. So,
really?
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, you know, PC was the rage, right? And mm-hmm. so PCBSD is where I started. Actually, I should say Unix.
Okay.
So original Unix and then PCBSD. From there, went to other flavors.
Okay.
I won't say what flavors they are. thank you. They are all open source. Let's start with that.
Yeah, sure.
So along the way, I have also gone to other other areas other than just operating system.
Mm-hmm.
Have done a lot of work in networking stacks. Has done a lot of work in application stacks. You know,
sure.
As recent as in the past few years, I've been focusing on financial. Very interesting because we have customers who are running FreeBSD that's in the financial space.
Okay.
And especially in the financial space, you don't just upgrade.
Yeah,
you
yeah.
have to go through requirements, audit, mm-hmm. Certification. And so that brought me back to FreeBSD as well because a lot of the customers that we work with have FreeBSD.
Mm-hmm.
And then Genuus, some of the company that I knew, we've been in conversations, and when they raised the possibility of having me to help the company drive the strategy in regards to collaborating and working based on FreeBSD, I thought that was a great opportunity.
Oh, fantastic.
So,
yeah. So I guess, can you talk about why Genuus picked FreeBSD as the base?
I won't use the joke that I started earlier. So, we did assessment of all the open source out there. The sure. number one reason, well, there are two number one reasons, so they're equal, right?
Mm-hmm.
Number one is reputation.
Okay.
The reliability, all right? And then the commitment to the operating system. The number two, of course, we all love it, is license.
Yeah.
The license allows us to, if we wanted to, do what we want with it, and we're not forced to have to commit mm-hmm. it back, mm-hmm. or you know, give you everything that we have built on top of. So the flexibility of the licensing plus the reputation was a great combo that we can pass up.
Mm-hmm.
And so that was those two of the number one reasons.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think the license is something that's undersold in a lot of cases, but the BSD license has gotten smaller as time's gone on. We have a 4-clause, a 3-clause, a 2-clause, whereas the Linux licenses have gotten bigger, right?
Yes, he has.
So I appreciate it because I don't need a lawyer to go look at what the license says. I can read that and go, yeah, we can do that.
It's two sentences.
Right?
That's it.
Right?
But there's a downstream benefit too.
Yeah.
The downstream benefit is we, of course, are based on FreeBSD, mm-hmm. right? Now, we also want everyone to come on to OpenServer 10, just like we want everyone to come on to FreeBSD. Do you want those people to be bound and gagged by licensing?
Mm-hmm.
No.
Sure. No, no.
You want to make it as easy as possible so mm-hmm. that anyone who wants to build a port or even want to improve upon FreeBSD should be able to do so. Mm-hmm. And so that kind of commitment and that kind of culture, you know, my prediction is we do this right, we'll be leaps and bounds across everyone else.
I agree with you there.
Yeah.
Yes, definitely.
Yeah, and that's an angle I guess most people might not consider, but why a company might pick something BSD license to base their product on, it's so that their customers can base their product on it
mm-hmm.
without having to, you know, the license flows
yeah.
through
yeah.
instead of, you know,
it's an inherited property if yeah. we want to talk in ZFS terms, yes. right?
So I won't give you the name of the companies.
Mm-hmm.
That effect is already in place.
Mm-hmm.
Foreign companies who want to come into the United States,
mm-hmm.
If they work with another IX vendor, to be named,
okay.
The paying is great. Licensing.
Sure.
And of course, the royalty, mm-hmm. right? So they're approaching us because it is FreeBSD.
Mm-hmm.
There are no licensing issues.
Yeah.
Zero. Mm-hmm. So these companies are approaching us today saying, can we work with you so that when we sell our hardware,
mm-hmm.
you're preload with OpenServer 10, which is free BSD.
Sure.
We all benefit from that. But the number one reason is licensing.
Yeah. That's great. So can you tell us a little bit about Zinio, some of the technologies you guys are using in FreeBSD? Anything special you're using there?
At the core, we're using it as is.
Okay.
Because the core product is very powerful.
Mm-hmm. Sure.
The components are powerful. The offering is very rich.
Mm-hmm.
So at the core, the only thing we're changing is probably just some of the names.
Okay.
You know, going to a financial company and says you can use Jail is probably not going to go over well.
Yeah, right?
You know, Wall Street have enough yes. of Jail, right?
Uh-huh. And
yeah. So we didn't want that kind of name to follow us into the customer site.
Sure, right? Sure.
So that's the. I mean, it's funny.
You can use the lockbox instead, or something.
Lockbox,
right?
You know, we named it Capsule for now.
Okay. Yeah.
So that there is no there are no baggages that goes with the names when we go into a customer and talk to them.
Mm-hmm.
But at the core, it's really as is. We're building value add on top of that.
Mm-hmm. Sure.
But it's still on top of the core, and our value add is probably all going to be ports and packages
mm-hmm.
that we'll add on top of that, and they're tremendous value. And so I'll leave it at that. Our roadmap is not public yet,
okay.
So I'll wait till it's public, mm-hmm. then we can talk about it in more general sense.
I sense a future interview.
Okay. Can you talk a little bit about what some of the technologies you use are? Like you mentioned Jails,
mm-hmm.
I can see you're using that, but are there any other?
Well, Beehive.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Beehive is strategic to mm-hmm. us. So since this is a public interview, I want to make it clear.
Mm-hmm.
We own, Zinio's own Skull assets.
Yes.
But we're not Skull.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? So Zinio's acquired the assets, right? In the process, we also acquire a set of customers who are still running Skull today
mm-hmm.
that will be migrating to OpenServer 10 sometime in the future.
Sure.
The migration strategy starts with having Skull running under Beehive, under OpenServer 10. So
fantastic.
You can see how important
yeah.
Beehive and OpenServer 10, FreeBSD,
wow.
it is, how important is that to us? So that's a huge component.
Oh, and as a guy who used to run a lot of open server, I can tell you, you know, you can't keep up the hardware, obviously.
No.
You can't buy that hardware anymore to run it.
Here's a smart guy right there with experience.
Right.
We cannot be certifying every Skull operating system
yeah.
to every hardware. But if we focus on just one, OpenServer 10, mm-hmm. right, and let Beehive handle the rest, our cost is lower.
Yep.
Our customers will be happier.
Mm-hmm.
Right. And part of the reason why you're still supporting the old one is because customers have apps they built
yeah
that they don't want to move
yeah
well those apps are often cost a ton of money to invest
mm-hmm.
in and build, and they work well enough for what they're doing, so
yeah.
why would you
and
change
just,
it
yeah so let's just have a layer to be able to keep doing
it. Exactly. We have one customer, they cannot migrate off Skull because they have to retrain 40,000 people,
yeah,
the employees, just... and so the cost of retraining 40,000 versus keep paying for it
mm-hmm.
is probably cheaper. Just keep paying
yeah,
for it.
Yeah,
yeah.
Sorry, you were asking.
No, it's just, are there any other technologies that are strategic for you?
Well, those are the top ones. Yes, there are, and we have to work together because this is this affects all of us.
Mm-hmm.
It affects FreeBSD. It affects Zinio, which is OpenStack.
Mm-hmm.
So. We need to get I don't want to say this with authority,
mm-hmm.
so I would say my strong recommendation
sure.
is that we need to get ahead of that train,
mm-hmm.
because the concept of on-premise installation is going away.
Mm-hmm.
Just people mm-hmm. don't want to deal with that anymore. They'd rather have it in the cloud,
yep.
launch it when they need it, change the sizes anytime they want, right? And just have it all out there, and that'd be so much easier.
Mm-hmm.
So we are going to offer OpenStack at some point, but we need to work with you
mm-hmm.
to sync up our schedule. And also with Jail, as you know, the others are offering as a container.
Yeah.
We'll be doing that too in the cloud. Mm-hmm. So we'll be offering that as a container. So absolutely,
yeah.
OpenStack is a huge direction for us as well.
Mm-hmm. So were there any other things that you think that the FreeBSD project could do better to work for you, or just in general? What other stuff would you like to see?
You know, I'm going to say, I'll turn that around and say, what can we do for you?
That was the next question.
Oh, that was the next question for you. Okay.
Let's see. I want a new bootloader. I want this and that. And could I get a pony? You know, like the wish list comes
Secure bootloader.
And ZFS, right? And encrypted ZFS at the same time.
Yeah.
The world will be a happy place, happier place.
That's right.
So, absolutely. They are, you know, I think the spirit of FreeBSD, keeping it pure, keeping it not tainted, is important, right? Let us worry about the commercial side.
Yeah. Sure.
Let us worry about what the customers want today, tomorrow, but you continue to focus on what's important, which is that core, right? And to keep it strong and keep it reliable and keep it good, you cannot be interfered. You cannot make sense. I understand that. And so I think you keep that principle and keep that going, and without violating that, I know you won't, we'll do just fine.
Okay.
We will, you know, if we need something new that you don't have yet, we'll add to it. But we want to add to a good foundation. We don't want to add to something that later all of us will regret. I've always said this, right, that we have to succeed together. You cannot take shortcuts because you'll affect us. We cannot build bad products on top of yours. You'll make you look bad because, you know, what they're going to do, right? They're not going to look at it as, oh, it's an add-on to FreeBSD. They're going to look at it as, that's FreeBSD. Regardless how you tell people, it's two separate, you know, it's a package on top of FreeBSD, right? Regardless how you spin that, that's the way they're going to look at it. And so, reputation is interdependent.
Well, cool. Was there anything else?
The second question was, what can Zinuous do?
Yes. I would like to, first and foremost, the first priority, right, is that continue to strengthen our bond, how we work together, how we collaborate. There are processes that we need to work and agree upon. For example, you are not going to be facing customer downtime. We will. And so we want to be able to, you know, in our SLA to say, yes, we'll fix that in 2 hours. But after we do that, we should have an agreement and strength come together and says, guess what, guys? Here's some problem that we had to fix. Can you take that back? Will you review that, bring that back into core? So that we don't become two separate trees that
So you don't diverge from
We don't want to do that because others have done that.
And we've heard the horror stories from everyone who come to these conferences and tell us we wish we never did that.
What was the other one just yesterday?
Who was it? Was it Isilon yesterday?
It was at the Dev Summit. There was Isilon and then
Juniper.
And Yahoo and a bunch of other ones. They've all done this thing, and then 5 years later, been like, well, now what do we do?
That was a mistake.
I don't want Zinuous to be having to make money to support the mistakes we make. Because a lot of companies have done that. Let's not do that.
For sure. And it's good to learn those lessons ahead of time.
Keep the delta small so that you can keep up.
So that's what we would like to do, is continue that collaboration and continue that the strength of working together, and most of all, whatever we can do to help FreeBSD.
Do you guys have any committers on staff yet?
We do. Well, we have one person who's close to being a committer, but I do have other committers in Bay Area that I'll be bringing into the company.
So
there are resources that we are going to be reach for that as well.
Great. Previously, there's been talk about Zinuous helping with the testing infrastructure on FreeBSD.
Absolutely. We're a big proponent on testing. Test first, you know? So, absolutely. That's the leadership in Zinuous already talked to me about that, about collaborating on testing strategy, maybe help out with funding on testing. Absolutely, that's an area that we need to.
It's an area that open source things have been weak on, especially historically, because that's not the fun part.
Well, that's kind of a thankless task, right? Yeah. The fun part is coming up.
Donating their time, they're going to work. You know, we only have so much time. We need
deadline. We want to make new stuff, not go back and test the old stuff, right?
Yeah, and make sure that every new change didn't affect any of the old stuff. And it is, you know, it's something that, you know, if you're building a product on customers that can't face downtime, testing becomes important.
Yes, it becomes very important. And yes, we should work on that together to come up with a cloud strategy to do that, so that we can do that 24/7. Mm-hmm. Anytime someone commits code, kick it off automatically, run it anywhere in the world, can go in, look at the results, right? And agree or disagree what the results are. And just as important, not just testing, benchmark, right?
Yeah. Does this hurt us or help us?
Yes, that's something I kind of always wanted to have. And people have done it in the past where they checked out a couple of different versions and compared network performance under the same load on a couple of different revisions. Mm-hmm. But it's like, I want a graph of every revision ever.
It would be nice to have an automated system where like every week it runs a server for a day or two even, just kind of checking weekly to say, hey, we got this performance this week, and next week it was this.
There was a big dip, or all of a sudden a big spike. Does that spike an improvement, or is that spike a bug, meaning something that used to be happening isn't happening now, and that's why it's faster?
Yeah. And you know what? That exists today.
Yeah.
I mean, I came from companies where we have DevOps, right?
Sure.
And you just use Jenkins, open source.
Yeah, that's what I'm doing today, is a lot of Jenkins stuff.
And then it's tied into Subversion, right? Everything is tied together, so the minute the codes check in, test is kicked off, and Jenkins managed that, and then you have all the scripts to run the tests, and then you get the results, and notification that goes to, right?
Yes, and we've seen that help quite a few times.
It does.
It's like somebody commits, and Jenkins is like, hey, one of these three commits broke something.
Yeah,
right.
But performance benchmark is a big one, because we need to provide infrastructure where we can test against 64 core machines, as an example.
Sure. Yeah.
And I am specifically in conversations with hardware companies, they're committed to working with us and providing these, you know, very expensive big machines. I want to make that available to FreeBSD.
That's
to
say, awesome.
You know, that's available. Let's do this together.
Yeah.
Whatever we do, let's do this together.
Yes.
Oh, fantastic. Well, do you have anything else you want to tell us about Zinnias, or when you guys have a planned release date? Are you allowed to?
No, I want to keep that open for now. Okay. But the only thing I would suggest is next time in the future, in conferences, try to have kids size t-shirts so I can take them back to my
right,
kids.
There you go.
Yeah.
That's a really good idea.
You've got to start with the future.
Right?
Look at Mac or Apple. They start out with college students.
That's right. Get them when they're young.
Yeah, when they are out of school, they're looking for Apple products.
That's right.
So let's start with the kids. Give them, you know, free BSD t-shirt. They go to school with it. The kids will ask about that. You are building that new generation.
That's fantastic. All right. We'll definitely, we know people, we'll talk to them about that.
Let's do that so that I can take it back to my kids.
My kids too, because they never get anything.
I got a little stuffed beastie once, and that was about it.
Okay, well, thank you so much for coming on the show.
Thank you,
really appreciate it.
Pleasure meeting both of you.
Okay, hope you guys enjoyed the interview. It's time for the news roundup. But quickly, before we get to that, we do want to mention DigitalOcean now. They're one of the sponsors here of BSD Now. And of course, they have that awesome coupon code. And I'm not sure when they're going to take that down, but you want to use it now. That way you don't get caught later. Especially if you're watching this show later, like, go try it now. Make sure it still works. But FreeBSD Now is the coupon code you can use on their site, which gives you that $10 credit, which, I mean, shoot, that's good for 2 months of running a VM there. Sit on SSDs. You can have FreeBSD in your VM. That's an officially supported thing that they have over at DigitalOcean. We also have instructions, if you're seeing this for the first time, on how you could throw OpenBSD up in a VM there as well. So DigitalOcean definitely has got some cool stuff you can do with it. In addition to having locations all across the world, great bandwidth and connectivity. The latency here to my place is fantastic. Yep. When I was trying the New York location, it was great.
And the storage is backed by SSD, so that's nice and fast. And you get a full gigabit connection rather than just like 100 megabits. Mm-hmm. So you get you could actually use up that terabyte of bandwidth if you're really keen
on
doing that.
That's right.
But you know, at that $5 price point, I've got a bunch of them running. I have a backup mail server because, you know, who doesn't? You might as well make sure your mail is going to work. And $5 is a good price for a backup mail server.
I should set up DNS up there that way too, so I have another DNS.
You know, and I got one up there just for a status page. You know, it's like we needed a page that we could easily post messages on if our website was ever down for some reason. or if, sure. if you know, if we're having problems and it's like, well, I can't really be answering every support email right now. I need to be working on the problem. So here's a URL that has an explanation of the problem and won't be affected by any problems anywhere else. And at the price of $5 a month, it's pretty hard to argue about it.
Okay. Well, they make it fast. I mean, their website says 55 seconds to spin up a droplet. Yep. So, I mean, come on. I mean, that's just enough time to fill out the info and click, and it's pretty much done. Exactly. So that's pretty awesome. And they have an API as well. So if you want to do that programmatically and tear up and spin up VMs, tear them down, do whatever, you can do that as well. So, again, DigitalOcean.com. Don't forget FreeBSD Now coupon code. Okay, so news roundup this week. And I did a little double take on this one when I saw it at first. TJ, I was like, wait, what? No, that can't be right. But yes. As he mentions here in the show notes, we definitely don't talk about 4.4 BSD a lot on the show.
No. That was before our time, as they would say.
Yes, yes. I was like, wait, what is that? Oh, yeah. And we have a link here to GitHub where there is now something called LightBSD, which is a variant of the 4.4 BSD operating system, which has been specifically adapted for microcontrollers. So if you got some really, really old hardware or you're working in the embedded space, then this may be an interesting hobby project to look at. And by hardware, I'll give you an example here on the GitHub site. It says it currently only the microchip PCI 32 megahertz family is supported as a target. It's equipped with an MMU with paging support and 512 whopping kilobytes of on-chip RAM. So how awesome is that? So
it explains, it's like, why did they base this on, 4.4 BSD from, what's that, the 80s or 90s?
I don't know.
Something. Yeah. It's got to be the 80s. Because FreeBSD started in like 91 or 93.
Yeah.
So yeah, it's old. And then when you see that they only had 512 kilobytes of RAM, it's like, I see why you might want to go something that old that's just the very basics.
Yeah,
the bare minimum. TCP IP stack and a shell or whatever to be able to run a couple of network embedded applications or whatever.
Well, he says here on the GitHub page that the resources are enough to build a compact network-embedded system. So I guess that's the target here. But if that's the space you play in, go definitely take a look at that. If anything, for historical purpose, it might be interesting to go look as well. Mm-hmm. Okay. So next up, we have HardenBSD announces their ASLR completion, which HardenBSD, for those who don't know, we've done an interview with them in the past, but they're a full-on fork of FreeBSD now. And they have declared that their ASLR patch set is complete. So let's bring that up here and we can read through some of the notes here. Some of their features of their ASLR implementation includes execution-based randomness of position-independent executables, or PIs, full stack randomization in addition to the random stack gap, RTLD-based randomization, MMAP randomization, VDSO randomization, and shared object load order randomization. So, wow, a lot of stuff has definitely made it in here. And they said they had an update to this where they've already fixed a few issues with that as well. So that is cool. I think that may have been the one he's talking about chat here that I ran into last week.
Yep, they also found at the bottom they mentioned fixing specific problems with ARM as well.
Mm-hmm. That's right. That's right. So, interesting. They said now that this is complete, they said our version of ASLR is the strongest form ever implemented in any BSD operating system. So, that is pretty cool. Mm-hmm. So, definitely take a look at that. That's at hardenbsd.org, of course. And we have a link to the announcement here. And you can read about that and see what these things will do for you here. So, they said there's only a few small things left to do, typical stuff, man page cleanups, and possibly a shared object load order improvements as well. Mm-hmm. So, of course, we'll bring that to you when that happens.
Yes. And now, hopefully, that the busy season is ended with exams and so on being over, some of the people in the right areas on FreeBSD will be able to review some of those the patches that Sean has been pending against FreeBSD for a while. Yeah, well, he's had one under review for quite a while, but Robert Watson was busy with exams and so on. He ended up not even being able to make it to BSDCAN because of that.
Oh yeah,
and then he's been traveling the last couple of weeks, so hopefully he'll now have time to actually dig into that and can get that more in line.
Well, of course, we will mention that on a future show when those land as well. Okay, next up, I know we've talked about OpenBSD and their pursuit for more SMP friendliness. Well, we have an article here called Unlock the Reaper, and we have a new patch that was posted that unlocks the Reaper in the kernel now. So when there's a zombie process causing a resource leak, it's the Reaper's job to deallocate those resources. And yes, we're still talking about computers, not horror movies here. And we have a link to the patch where you can take a look at what's going on here. And we have some results as well, where some initial testing has yielded some positive results and no regressions as far as we know. Mm-hmm. So it looks like they're looking for more testers of this. So if you want to install a current snapshot, you can get that automatically and try it out. And also we have a link to looks like an updated version of the patch is coming soon. And a hackathon is going on right now, so we'll probably see some more SMP improvements here in the very near future.
Yes, so I'll look forward to at EuroBSDCon seeing the updated version of Henning's talk about OpenBSD sucks, and it will have an updated report on where they are on the getting everything unlocked.
That's right. So it looks like the updated patch that they're working on, they found a lock order reversal. So they're working on a fix for that at the moment. So hopefully that'll land here in the near future.
Nice.
Okay. Next up, we have Adrian Chad, who we've talked to before and famous in the FreeBSD community. This guy does a lot of cool stuff. Yep. And he writes up a blog post about mentoring new users and tells a story about how he originally got into FreeBSD.
Yeah, so I thought I've heard a little bit of the story before, but it's always interesting to hear these the full detailed backstory of some of the interesting people you've come to know over the years.
Yeah, that's right. So it turns out Julian Escher was the one who gave him his start in the BSD community here, introduced it to him. He was only 11 at the time. Yeah, so beat me to it, man.
Yeah, that was. I wish I had been introduced to BSD when I was 11. Mm-hmm. He says, you know, so here he was, 11-year-old Adrian in the early 90s, and he was hiding in his bedroom trying to make a crystal radio set out of some random parts and scraping away the paint on his windowsill. Mm-hmm. But then his aunt came over to visit, and she had a new boyfriend, and he was like, "Hi, I'm Julian." And that wasn't all that interesting at first. And then he was like, "Oh, are you trying to make a crystal radio set? And okay, so that was interesting," and so on. And, you know, he said suddenly he had someone role model-ish in his life, and they had kind of appeared out of the blue, and, you know, he felt mostly alone most of the time, and then all of a sudden someone shows up who he can look up to and relate to, and so he Jason said he turned into a sponge and learned everything he could, everything Julian would show him. When he would come over, he'd bring some new interesting story or some thing to show him or whatever. And then eventually he showed better ways of building transistor switch circuits and, do other random things that he was doing when he was a teenager. And then he saved up and bought his first PC, and Julian started showing him how to do programming. He says, I was already programming. My parents had saved up and bought a Amstrad CPC 464, which is some old computer I'd never heard of. And then he had a secondhand Commodore 64 for a little while, but that eventually somehow stopped working, and I didn't have the clue on how to fix it. And he says, but he was programming in, Locomotive BASIC and dabbling with a Z80. When he was 12, and then he upgraded to a Turbo Pascal 6 when he hit high school. And he talks about that, and eventually stumbling into C and playing with that. And he says, then one day Julian explained task switching to him while they were walking along the beach in Australia. And he's, explained that computers don't just, computers appear to be able to do multiple things at once, but really it's just that, back in single CPU systems, the CPU would just let program one run for a couple of milliseconds and let program two run for a couple of milliseconds and program three for a couple
of
milliseconds.
It's a trick of the eyes, right? It's too fast to notice.
Yeah. But the CPU just does one thing at a time, and you just switch which thing you're running really quickly, and it appears to be multitasking. With that bright spark planted in my head, I went home and started dreaming up ways to make my Z80-based CPC do something like that. And he says, as soon as I was old enough, my mother dragged me to McDonald's to apply for a job. As soon as I was legally able to do so, which apparently in Australia was 14 years and 9 months, he said he saw a computer at a secondhand computer shop, and he paid $500 for an IBM PC-AT with an EGA monitor and two floppy disks, floppy disk drives. Then he put down a down payment and paid it off himself with his minimum wage job. once he got it home, he acquired a copy of Turbo Pascal and started off drawing fractals and stuff. Hmm. And then, you know, it was Julian's fault that he discovered FreeBSD. One day he showed, Adrian was shown Julian's computer and was running something called BSD, and he was trying to explain the Bourne shell scripting and how the installer worked. I nodded, but was very confused, and eventually went back to VGA programming book he had lent me. And
even back then, you had to explain how the install.
Yes. But then he showed him FractInt running in X, which could draw much more interesting fractals. And all of a sudden, Adrian was very interested. And then, so he took the VGA book home and started learning how to use all the higher resolutions and stuff. And he says, the one thing that stuck in his mind, there was too much bit plane work. And he says, reading from VGA memory is one of the slowest things you can do. Don't do it, ever. And he has a special note in there for console driver authors. Mm-hmm. But he goes on to talk about, you know, starting up with getting a 286 and finally having a full VGA monitor and having a 486 that had a Sound Blaster card, and the CD-ROM mm-hmm. drive was connected via the Sound Blaster card, because originally CDs were for music, right? And so mm-hmm. if you had a data CD, you could actually play it as basically static into the video card, and then the OS could read it. But at the time, FreeBSD 1.1 didn't understand how to do that. It was quite interesting when we were looking at a picture of somebody's CD set of FreeBSD, and one of the 2.x CDs on the back specifically lists the CD-ROM connected via the Sound Blaster is supported. But back with FreeBSD 1.1, it wasn't. So Adrian was playing around with Slackware Linux, and then eventually FreeBSD 2 came out and it had support for his card, and he started using that. Plus, by then, he had a regular IDE CD-ROM. And he talks about starting working at an ISP when he was in high school, and then getting in a big argument about running the Squid server at the ISP on Linux instead of FreeBSD. And eventually, I convinced him that FreeBSD was better. And then fast forward a couple years after that, and he's been hacking on FreeBSD here and there and gotten a little trouble before he finished high school. And then he got reminded when PHK wrote a story on the mailing list recently, and that's when Adrian got his commit bit, and he doesn't remember exactly where it was, but he couldn't have been much older than 20 at the time.
Wow.
And then his conclusion is, this is why mentoring kids is important. It may seem like a waste of time. It may seem like they don't understand, but we were all there once. We wanted someone to relate to, someone to look up to, and someone, you know, something interesting to do. And for Adrian, Julian was that person, and I owe him and his mother for making all that possible. And he says, he also mentions, this is why you don't skimp on hardware support for popular, if cheaper, platforms and shiny looking features if you want people to adopt your stuff. But he says, that's a completely different rant.
Well, yeah, and then he leaves us the little tidbit on some of the shiny mm-hmm. features he's working on here. He said he's going back to hacking on the VGA Visa bootloader support for FreeBSD Head. He said, that's long overdue, and I want my pretty splash screen. Amen. Preach it, mm-hmm. Adrian. Let me know when you have patches. I'd like to test that.
Yes.
That would be awesome. But yeah, that's fantastic. Okay, we got some good feedback and questions this week, but before we hop right into that, of course, we want to mention the Tarsnap, and the URL for that's going to be tarsnap.com/BSDnow. And we got something cool to show you this week. Mm-hmm. It looks like a new GUI has landed for Tarsnap. So if you want to do something not from the command line, this is kind of neat. And it looks pretty good, too. It's yes. Qt-based. So, Alan, I'll let you narrate this since you got the screen up there.
Yeah, so basically, there's a post over on the Tarsnap mailing list, but a user was like, well, I know all you guys are command line guys and love it. I really like Tarsnap, but I'm a Mac user and I like graphical interfaces. So he mm-hmm. wrote one here in Qt. And so it's cross-platform. Mm-hmm. It works on FreeBSD and a bunch of other platforms. But he has it here, a screenshot of it running on his Mac. And he's able to search his files and make sure things are backed up and basically have a graphical management of what files to back up, what archives he has so he can decide what to keep and what to prune and so on, the mm-hmm. jobs he has set up to automatically run, and control all the settings. So nice. It seems like it'd be a nice way to make it more usable for different platforms. So I'm going to have to try this out on my laptop because I'd love to have Tarsnap on my laptop.
Let me check and see if it's in the port stream real quick here. But yeah, this is definitely a cool thing here. Mm-hmm. Tarsnap. Let's see what we got. I don't see the GUI yet. Maybe it's around somewhere. But hopefully it'll land in the port stream here soon, and then we'll just have packages of it.
Maybe some helpful member of the audience will want it too, and we'll make a port of it.
If it's Qt-based, it's real easy to port over, folks. Yep. This could be your first port, and then you could write a blog article, and then we could talk about it later, and that would be really cool.
Yes. We'd love to see some more My First Port posts or getting my first bug actually fixed or something, right? It's one thing to report a bug on Bugzilla, but if you actually also include a patch and then actually get it committed and your name in the commit log and so on, we'd love to talk more about that and get more people to do that.
That's right. So we'll have the link in the show notes here, but it's up on GitHub, and it's tarsnap with a capital T, and then tarsnap/GUI. So you can take a look at that. And, of course, tarsnap, if you don't have that set up yet, you'll probably need that if you're planning on trying the GUI out. So you go to tarsnap.com, make an account, put a couple bucks in there, and that'll last you quite a while because it's dirt cheap. Your backups, of course, all encrypted, and everything is stored off-site and encrypted before it leaves your box, and all the fancy deduplications done automatically in the background. And if you don't trust us or don't believe it, sounds too good to be true, go look at the code yourself. Exactly. It's there. It's been published. And if you find a bug, submit it for a reward. And he's got a list of bounties up on the website there. But Tarsnap makes that all simple. So if you're a command line guy, you got a tar-like functionality as well. So learning curve's actually pretty easy.
Yep. I've been using it since January. Love it.
That's right. Yeah, I know. It's great. Okay. Well, let's get into the questions here, Alan. We got the first one is from Sean asking about a VPS jail. Do you want to take this one? I'll grab the next one.
Sure. He says he's got a DigitalOcean droplet that we've been talking about on the show, and he's interested in setting up a jail since he only wants to test something very minor. So he's looking at a tutorial, but he doesn't understand about the aliasing the IP addresses. He says, do I need to have an already available IP address on the host machine first? So it depends what you want to do. If you want to run extra stuff like services in the jail, oftentimes you'll want a separate IP address. When you only have one IP address, like in the instance of the server where you haven't bought additional IP addresses, you have a couple of options. The alias IP address you use for the jail can be something off your loopback adapter. So 127.0.0.2 is common for jails. You can use the IP address of your host system as well. They won't conflict. However, if you run a service in the jail, it will overlap the service on the host. So, for example, if you're running SSH on the host and you only have one IP address, and then you start a jail and you start the SSHD in the jail, if you try to SSH in, you're only ever going to connect to the one in the jail, and you've locked yourself out of the host. Luckily, DigitalOcean provides you with the console, so you can get around that and get back in if you ever do lock yourself out like that. But if you're on a different kind of server where you don't have console access, that could actually be really bad. So you can reuse the same IP address, or you can use something like 127.0.0.2 or something and set up NAT to forward that out over your one IP address, which is definitely the solution you probably want if you're going to have more than one jail.
Sure.
That kind of lets you decide which one of those ways you want to do it.
Cool deal. Okay. Well, next up we have Hermano, who writes in asking about Lumina. He said, "Hey guys, been listening to your show for a while and love it." He said, "I have a few PowerPC machines which all run Linux." He said, "I wanted to give FreeBSD a try and installed it on my iBook G4. The base install went flawless and I have Xorg running and working. However, when I tried to install the port for Lumina, the install keeps failing." He said, "I offered the suggestion to set make jobs unsafe, yes, and rebuild. I did this, and it still failed. Is it at all possible to run Lumina on PowerPC? Right now I'm installing XFCE, but would definitely love to give Lumina a try." So we communicated with him a little bit this week via email, and what we found was wasn't a problem building Lumina. It was the QMake port, which is part of Qt. Which, of course, Lumina depends on, being that it's written in Qt. So I believe he's reported this upstream, and hopefully we'll have a fix in the port tree here soon for a PowerPC compilation of that port. And once that's there, then Lumina should be able to compile just fine.
Does FreeBSD have binary packages for PowerPC?
I don't know if they do anymore.
Yeah, because if they did, I wonder if maybe you could just get a binary package of that dependency and solve
that. But if they did, you think that would have been broken in Poudre as well, because the error looked like likely. Something specific.
Yeah. Yeah, so, I don't think PowerPC is that used anymore. I know there's
just
some
not
look
a lot
at,
of people on it anymore.
I know there's some look at revived interest in certain parts of it for high-end servers, but you know, obviously interest in old iBook G4s is dwindling.
Yeah, right. Okay. Well, next up, we have a Stuart who writes in with a NAT follow-up. He said, hey, all. Someone else may have already emailed you this. He said, I can't be the only person. He said, but I remember this sort of question has been asked before on Security Now, talking about gaming systems. And he sent us the link for that. He said, you need to put the Xboxes on their own NATed network. That way the open ports are only open by the router and shared between the Xboxes. He said, Steve Gibson does a better job of explaining it there. And there's the transcript. He also says he loves the shows, ZFS user for 3+ years. Also, I have a tip. If you have 100 gigabytes of data to move and only a 64 gigabyte USB, ZFS plus compression is king. Unless you already compressed that
100 yeah, gigs. If it's 100 gigs of video, it won't compress. But
right?
Yes, that is. That's definitely oftentimes you can get performance like that. And then on top of everything else, it also ends up going faster, right? If you know your USB stick can do like 35 megabytes a second like mine can, if you add compression, all of a sudden you're writing faster than is physically possible.
That's right. That's right.
We also actually, what was the guy we interviewed last week's Lee?
Oh, I messed that one, right?
Right. Yes. Skype issues. Okay. But at the end of his interview, separately, he mentioned, actually having investigated that once before because the boss at some place he worked paid him to figure out why his two Xboxes wouldn't work. And I have a video clip of that. I'll have to dig that out and we'll have to find the answer.
Speaking of, we got more feedback about that in the next one. I'll let you read this one. Okay. I'll close this out.
So this is from Richard about NAT follow-up. He says, one way that could solve the problem is to put a NAT router into their wired network, a port forwarding all the required Xbox 360 ports to the side that faces them on the wired network, then connect all the Xbox 360s to the new router. I'm not entirely sure what he was describing there.
Yeah.
But it seems that in the end, the problem is that both Xboxes always want to use the same port, and this causes issues. So I think the small wall guy's suggestion was putting them in two separate subnets behind the same router and doing it that way.
Cool. Okay. Well, thank you for writing in, Richard, and to everyone else who wrote in. We appreciate that. Mm-hmm. And, of course, we want to encourage more people to do that. So the way you can do it is you go to feedback@bsdnow.tv. That's the way to get in touch with us. Send emails there if you have any ideas or topics or stories you want mentioned on the show. Even if you think we may have seen it, it's just best to drop us a line in case we did, because that has been known to happen before. And also, it looks like Calgary, Alberta area in Canada, there's going to be an OpenBSD developer speaking event at the Southern Alberta Institute of Technology. And we have links there to that. This is taking place 5 days from when we're recording this, so July 20th. Mm-hmm. So it's right after the hackathon they're having there. They'll be discussing some of the work that was done, maybe with a Q&A session. Do we know if they're recording that, Alan?
I don't think they are. I don't know. Okay. So they're having a private invite-only hackathon, but after they're having an open discussion where everybody's invited. And so they have a room at the university there, and they're inviting people that want to come out.
Sure. Well, if they don't record it, somebody take good notes and write a blog article somewhere and send that in, because we'd love to discuss and hear about what happened there.
Undeadly.org usually has quite a few good notes after every one of their hackathons, so we look forward to sharing those with you in the coming weeks.
Cool. Also, we want to mention we are looking for some good new interviews, so get in touch if you've been doing anything cool with BSD and you'd like to talk about it. Even if you've come on the show before, say it was a year ago, but you're already working on something new, like, you know, Visa Boot Splash support or, you know, whatever it is,
Yes, because Adrian also recently committed a bunch of the NUMA stuff he had been working on. That's actually in the tree now.
Yeah, we'd like to pick your brain about that as well, and I'm sure the audience would be curious to hear what's been happening in those new spaces. So get in touch with us again. We will schedule an interview with you, and would love to see you on a future episode of BSD Now.